Touched and that we'll be encouraged about the things that you have for us. And we thank you and praise you and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come, we're going to sing together.
Amen. Seek your freedom today, Lord, because of your peace, your love, and your joy. Send your Holy Spirit now, Lord.
Blessed be your name, God, that is plenty for the great.
We got to realize that we can only surrender to the Lord as His will, His knowledge, His way is the only way. Oh, to Jesus I surrender all, to Him I
Thank you. That song to me is very powerful. Some of you know the history of that song. The guy lost a lot of his family. He sat down and wrote that song. What he was saying was, my source of strength, my happiness, my joy is not based upon temporal circumstances. It's founded upon something solid. And I love that, especially in our day and age with all the silly. I know most of us wish we could just take 2020 and just put it somewhere else and let's start new. But with all the stuff that's going on, the loss of life, the loss of this, the loss of that, and this and then that, is it well with your soul? Is it well with your soul? Now, if your soul is locked into something solid like Jesus, the Word of God, something that does not change, it is well. However, if it's linked to something that's temporary, transitory, moving, this guy is, you know. So it's very, that song is to be very apropos for our service today. It is well because my soul is anchored in Him. Amen. My soul is anchored in the Word of God. Amen. My soul is anchored in the fact that He loves me irrespective of whatever's happening in my life. Yes. It is well. Are there any testimonies if you were to share with us about what God has done in your life in the last 7 days or so? Hand back in the back.
We probably don't think about it as much, but the Lord has saved me some money this week.
God saved
me. I had a problem with my vehicle, and it got repaired to the cost.
Oh, anybody else?
I just wanted to say this morning we had a Sunday school class that was so spot on that only we decided God could have made it happen this week. But I just wanted to read this one sentence that we talked about. It says, and as you just said, it's well with our soul and with everything that's come around us and everything. There is no real power except that which comes from God. Satan may test us, but only because God allows it, in order that we may be strengthened. So I pray that we are all strengthened in this day of some troubles and trials that we're going through with everything this whole year, like you said, that is only strengthened us to trust God. He's in power, He's on the throne.
Amen. Like that. Yeah. Men get together on Wednesdays. We've been going this six-week series. And one thing about it, it keeps saying, this, all of our lesson we talk about today is a mirror. You look into it and look at yourself. How will you respond? How will you deal with it? So I like that. Some of the stuff that's going on in your life right now is a mirror saying, because like right now I can say I'm the biggest, the baddest, whatever like that. But until the pressure comes on, you see how big and bad you really are. And that's, for some of us, the mirror is coming up. And if you don't like what you see in the mirror, you have the power with Jesus to change it. Any other testimonies? Yes.
There's a 21-year-old kid that just had a full Ironman yesterday.
With Down syndrome.
With Down syndrome.
What happened?
He did a full Ironman.
Wow.
Whoa.
2.4 miles from him. I'm on my bike in 26.1 minutes.
Down syndrome.
And he made a whole life.
Oh! Praise God. Okay. All this is possible. I like that. Any prayer requests?
I have one for a person I don't even know, but she and her significant other were hit by a car on bicycles, and he got out of the hospital with scrapes and bad bruises. She has been in intensive care, out of intensive care, back in intensive care, collapsed lung, broken ribs, all kinds of issues. Anyway, she really needs a prayer. She's at death's door.
We will pray.
Her name's Jessica.
Jessica, thank you. You were saying something, Tom?
Yeah, not a prayer that he can heal and get all the treatment. He's going to have chemo for 3 to 6 weeks.
Okay, Pastor Doug, something, yes?
Can you pray that the country healing since we're talking about healing?
Amen. Country healing. Amen.
Pray for a resident.
anytime he might be dead by the time I get the door. And his family needs prayers.
A friend named Caitlin, who is having some cancer issues, that it's easily resolved. And also, I just want to pray for Lily. She's got a lot on her plate. And she's a little 20-year-old trying to be a 40-year-old. And it's hard on her. Not on her purpose, but because of life circumstances. Raising a baby, raising her brother.
Amen. Last week we prayed for our wife's, Lois's nephew's father-in-law had COVID back in Kansas City, and he just passed away a day or two ago, and just pray for that family and try to help them heal. Pray for the country's control, let's get the virus under control.
I just want to pray. I personally know several Christians that are very upset right now, anxious, confused, in some kind of personal nightmare, and I feel personally at total peace. I'm really blessed with that. But I just want to pray for people that are having a real struggle right now, that God will just, give them that peace to know everything is in His hands.
My grandmother is home, but she still needs prayers. She's still not feeling too good. They had to get her out of the hospital because of COVID.
Gotcha. Let's pray.
My son has a sister who goes up to Washington and just got diagnosed. She has to get kidney stones, and she's not working. It's precious.
Gotcha. Let's pray. Father, we worship you. We bless you. And thank you, Lord, that you are our strength. You're our source. You're who we put our hope in, and we glorify your name. Father, we're going to pray for these different things, and Lord, we're asking that your perfect will be done in every circumstance and situation. Father, we pray for this lady, Jessica. Ask in Jesus' name. She's gone in and out of intensive care. First of all, we thank you that her life was spared. And Father, we're asking in the name of Jesus that you continually show mercy to her, help the doctors, all the people involved to be able to figure out what's going on. But most of all, thank you, Lord, for healing this person. We thank you, Lord, for drawing her to you. Send people around her to encourage her in the things of God. We thank you for Pastor Doug, Lord God. And as he goes these treatments, we thank you, Lord God, that you will eradicate the cancer. We thank you, Lord God, for healing him. We thank you, Lord, for having mercy upon him. We thank you for the many friends that are surrounding him to encourage him during this season. Father, we do pray for this country. And Father God, we thank you, Lord, that we are called Americans. We thank you, Lord, for your hand upon America over the centuries. And Father, we're asking in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that by your Spirit you begin to heal the hurts, the wounds. Father, we ask in Jesus' name that we once again become a nation under God. Once again, we be a nation that is united. Father God, we're asking, Lord God, that you have mercy on us. As a nation, we have sinned against you. We've abandoned you. We don't give you time. We don't do all kinds of stuff. So, Lord, forgive us for our trespass. Forgive us for what we have done against you. But Lord, have mercy upon us, Lord God. Have mercy upon us. And we thank you for bringing healing too. Father, we thank you, Lord, this COVID thing. We know it's a subset of something else. But Lord, as we come right with you, as you heal this nation, thank you, Lord God, that you'll heal us of all the viruses too. Father, we trust you. Father, we know years ago this country was set apart. People came here to have freedom of religion, to worship you, to have a place where they can do that. And Father, we're asking in Jesus' name, but Father God, you're putting us back to that place, allowing you to be that we will be under your control, that we will be under your dominion, that we will be under your word. Father God, help America, heal America, we ask in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for this resident who's dying. Father, we're asking in the name of Jesus. Father, this couple, that we ask that you'd have mercy upon them, Lord God. We understand that death happens. Father, it's a part of life, unfortunately. But Father, we're asking in Jesus' name that this person, whatever condition they're, draw them to you, Lord God, so that their last moments on this earth will be joined with you. We pray, Lord God, for the surviving spouse, and we're asking in Jesus' name that you help them to comfort, strengthen, we ask in the name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you for Kate, Lord God, with the cancer issues. Father, I don't know the details. You know everything. So we're asking that you continue to have mercy, that Father, you work these details out, and Father, we're asking for healing to this person. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for Lily. Father, we actually saw her last night. We're asking that you continually work in her life. We thank you, Lord God, for helping her with all the load that she carries. Help her, Lord God, to begin to trust you in every area. Thank you for having mercy upon her. Thank you for giving her additional grace as she reaches out to her family. But most of all, thank you, Lord God, for drawing her closer to you in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the father-in-law who passed away. We pray for the family, Lord God, that you'd bring comfort, that you'd console. Father, we're asking in the name of Jesus that you continue to work in this family to encourage them, bring forth healing and wholeness. But Lord, most of all, in this new season, help them to trust you in Jesus' name. Father God, we pray for the people who are struggling with the electoral whole situation. Father, we're just asking you to comfort people. The people that are struggling, the people that don't understand, the people that are wondering about what happened or didn't happen. Father, comfort them. Help each one of us to trust you in the situation. Help us, Lord God, to rely upon you. These people that we're talking about, they're really struggling. Help them, Lord, to turn to you. Father God, you are God, and you have everything under control, and we're trusting you. You said you lift up one, you put down another, but Lord, we trust you to work all the details out, and we bless you for that in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for this grandmother, Lord, and ask in Jesus' name that you continue to work in her life, that, Lord God, you would help her, Lord God, to just really draw close to you. Keep her in good health. Help her, Lord God, what she's dealing with. But most of all, thank you, Lord, for helping the family also in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for Gretchen, Lord, and ask in the name of Jesus that you would reach into the situation and bring healing, wholeness, and comfort. Father, we're asking in Jesus' name that you place people around her and be able to share the truth of your word with her, and we thank you for that. Father, we do want to pray for the missionaries, both inside of America and outside of America, that you continue to work with them, that you keep them in good health, that you give them creative ways to minister, even in this COVID-19 season. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the commitment they have to you, and Lord, we thank you that you're protecting them. In Jesus' name. Father, we pray for the elected leaders and those that are not elected. We ask in the name of Jesus that you help them, Lord God, to allow you to work in their lives. Help them to understand your hand in their lives. And help, Lord God, thankfulness to come across this nation, to be trusting you to work everything out. We pray, Lord God, for the president-elect. We pray for all of those people, that each one would begin to say, Lord, you allow this to happen. I'm going to trust you with the details. Father, help each one, Lord God, whether a senator, whether a congressperson, we're asking that each person will say, Lord, I need you to make a place where it needs to be. So, Lord God, move, we ask in the name of Jesus. And Father, we're going to pray for our first responders, the nurses, the doctors. We're going to pray for the policemen. We're going to pray, Lord God, for the military. Everyone that goes into the fire instead of running from it. Father, we're asking in Jesus' name, you would be their strength, and Lord, they would know that it's all about you, that you are their strength and their God provider. Help them, we ask in Jesus' name. And Father God, we pray for everyone in here. Each one of us has things that we're dealing with. So Lord God, we look to you now and ask in Jesus' name that you sort out the details, that you work out every part of the things that we are concerned about. Father, we're trusting you as our Father in Jesus' name. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We get to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. And as you leave, there's the tray like this back there. We're not passing it around as you leave. This is the time we say, Lord, we worship you. You are our provider. You are the one that's our source. We trust in you to work every detail out. Father, we worship you with our tithes and our offerings. We say thank you for your goodness to each one of us. Father God, we worship you now. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're getting ready to have special music right now. Thank you.
Think about the signs that would be that he turned the water into wine. That was original. We see all the other stuff that went on past that, that Jesus did these signs. And an interesting thing is he didn't do them, he wasn't under the darkness, and he wasn't, nobody could see him, but he was right out in the open. People could see the fact that he was doing these signs. So it was in the open. It was so that people could see it and so that people could believe. But this is kind of the issue that we face. Not only did Jesus face it in his day, but I want to suggest to you that we still, in our day, face this idea of we tell people they see things that God has done, and they still don't believe. And that's one of the things that swept across our nation and around the world. We see in other parts of the world more people responding to the love of Christ. And here we kind of have shied away from it. We don't really want to talk about it. So we have a responsibility. We have a responsibility to be carriers of Christ to the world. And whether they believe or not really isn't our issue. It's the issues with their relationship with Christ. So let's march on. So that the word of Isaiah, the prophet, might be fulfilled, which he spoke. Listen to the Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed. And he had revealed it to the Jewish people. Jesus had been there with the Jewish people. He revealed it to them. For this cause they could not believe. And here's what Isaiah said again. He has blinded, that's Jesus, God has blinded their eyes, and he hardened their hearts, lest they see with their eyes and perceive with their heart and be converted, and I heal them. He blinded them, but he gave them the opportunity to see and to believe. And so this opportunity was there, and right with them was Christ himself, the Son of God, was there. They still wouldn't open their eyes. They wouldn't undo their heart, and they wouldn't believe in him. So as people of our time, which is now a couple thousand years later, when we run up against the hardness of many people's hearts, it's not something that we're going to necessarily chisel away. We can maybe love it away, but it's up to God to do that. We need to be the people that present and live our life out in a way that glorifies God and draws people to him. So he goes on to say, these things Isaiah said, because he saw his glory, and he spoke of him. So again, Isaiah saw his glory. He spoke of God. Ultimately, it's going to see, we're going to talk about his son in a second. But he came. And so this has been, God has been revealing himself to the world since Adam and Eve fell in the garden. He's not taken that away. He reveals himself to us every day in nature. He reveals himself. I was just north a couple weeks ago, and the colors of the trees were there. That doesn't happen just once in a while. That happens every year. That's amazing, but every year. And now the leaves are pretty well gone, I'm sure, up there. In fact, they've had snow in that sense. But in nature, we move the clocks. Remember, we moved the clocks ahead an hour, and we moved it back. But the sun still came up right when it was supposed to. And that didn't change the sun. That didn't change God's work at all. But God does it. He's faithful every day in the seasons, every day in the up and down of the sun. He's faithful in providing the air for us. He's faithful. He's faithful. He's faithful. We can see his presence in our lives every day of the year, every day of the week, every day that we live, we can see God's presence if we look. If we're not people that are believers and aren't looking, then we attribute it to some other force, I suppose. Nevertheless, in verse 42, many even of the rulers believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they were not confessing him, lest they would be put out of the synagogue. So a lot of the leaders were saying, well, you know, this Jesus guy, he's a good guy. He looks like he really is what he says he is. But because of what people might say about them, they wouldn't confess him. They were afraid that they were going to be put out of the synagogue. Put out. And we have people, we see people that we know that profess to be Christ, but they don't say anything because they might be put out of wherever it is. They might be put out of their friends. I know this is kind of from personal experience, but Years ago, I wasn't always a Christian, and I said hard to leave because I'm such a wonderful mom. No, that's not true. Yeah, I know, I did. But once you become a follower and you began to live your life, it's amazing how people want to kind of not necessarily hang with you because it looks bad. And you may not have experienced that, but that was one of the things that I still know the people, but we're not like, I think I've related this before. We first moved to the villages a long time ago. We had a home over in Belvedere, and we had a Christmas party. And we invited all of the neighbors, and all of them came. But most of them all had parties, but they never invited us again because we didn't serve liquor and alcohol. So that basically. So I'm saying that when you stand for Christ, people are going to not necessarily want to be around. And this is what these guys were afraid of. They were afraid if they confessed Christ, they'd get kicked out. And they didn't want to. They wanted to be important in man's eyes and not care about God. For they love the approval of men rather than the approval of God. They love the approval of men rather than the approval of God. And this is a situation that still exists in our world today. People are still confused and concerned about that because they don't want to be eliminated from whatever group of people that you attend to. Yesterday I went to the pharmacy because one of my medicines is about to run out. It seems like that happens every day almost, but anyway, I don't know about you. But the pharmacist said, pardon? Oh, the pharmacist said to me, man, he said, I've been having a hard time, but I really love your daily devotions. I thought, well, praise the Lord. I mean, so really that was a real encouragement to me because here's this guy who I've seen over the last year or two quite a bit because of in and out, but he's had taken time, he asked about the church and he went on the website and he was taking time and being encouraged by the devotions that he was seeing. And so I know Dodge and Derek, they both did work on those along with me. And so see that somebody's actually watching it is encouragement, and they're encouraged by it. So, but he was thankful for that. It just, that's the kind of thing sometimes you don't really hear about. But we want to be approved by man, but what we need to be concerned about is that we are approved by God. Then he goes on to say, and Jesus cried out and said, here's Jesus speaking, he who believes in me does not believe in me, but in him who sent me. He said, if you believe in me, you're not really me, but you're believing in God that sent me. And really, he came to glorify God. He was here as the Savior, but he was here to explain about his Father and to turn everything upward to him. And then he goes on to say, and he who beholds me beholds the one who sent me. If you see, and he was saying, if you see me, you see God. And when we are in a relationship with Jesus, we are all involved in the relationship with God the Father. We see him, we're involved with him, and we're also involved with God the Father. And then he goes on to say, and I have come as light into the world that everyone who believes in me may not remain in darkness. He said, I came to glorify my Father. You've seen me, you've seen the Father. And he said, I came to give light, and that light is so that you will become out of the darkness of the world, darkness of the bondage of sin, into the city of lights, and you'll be one who is then able to share the gospel, but also not only that, but that you can live and you take that light that he has, the Holy Spirit, with us into the darkness. That's what God's called us to do. And then in verse 47, somebody quote John 3:16. Wow, great job. Y'all get a gold star today. And what, quote John 3:17. Hold. Okay. That's not quite as well known. We don't see that sign in the wall. Listen to this. Verse 47. Chapter 12. Listen to what this says. And if anyone hears my sayings and does not keep them, I do not judge him. Listen now, listen to the rest now. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. Listen, we love judging. Right? This is right. Yeah, you can say, yeah, that's right. And we all do it. We all judge people about what they're going to do. There's a lot of judging going on right now because of what's happened this last week. But Jesus said, we didn't come to judge. We go into the world to save, to bring salvation. There's a tremendous difference in the way that we live our life out in front of people. And so I want to encourage you to think about this verse, because this verse is really, really powerful. John 3:17 is powerful. There might be another one that says it too, but it's really powerful in the fact that we want to be judgmental, and God wants us, Jesus wants us, the Holy Spirit wants us to be bringing salvation, and He'll take care of the judgment. He says that right after. He said, he who rejects me and does not receive my sayings, he is the one who has the one who judges him. The word I spoke is what will judge him at the last day. Listen, we don't have to judge people, because the Word of God takes care of that. The person judges themselves in the fact that they reject the Lord Jesus Christ and reject His Word. That rejection is the judgment. They're already judged. That's what Jesus is saying. They've already been judged. They've already been judged, and they need to have salvation, not judgment. So as a people of God, as people of God, we need to be people that carry the light. Jesus said, I'm the light. We carry the light into the world, not saying, boy, you're a dirty, rotten person, but that you need to know Christ and that you can be washed clean, because you are a dirty, rotten person. But we don't say it that way. We say it so you can have an opportunity to be washed clean in the power and by the blood of Christ, the blood that washes us clean. And so, verse 49, for I did not speak on my own initiative, but the Father himself who sent me has given me commandment what to say and what to speak. Jesus said, I didn't speak on my own. He said, God, the Father, told me what to speak, and that I'm speaking it to you now. And now, he brings the Holy Spirit, comes because he's gone away. But so when God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, wherever they're working, they work as three in one. They're not one working here and one working there. They're always together, and they're always led by the Father into the Son and through the Spirit. They're led to take care that we reach out to a lost and hurting world. And somebody sent out a thing this week about, you know, I don't live by the Democrats, I don't live by the Republicans, the donkey or the elephant, but by the Lamb of God. By the Lamb. And the Lamb doesn't have to fight back. The Lamb doesn't go make judgment. The Lamb just tries to survive in other fathers with the shepherd's strength. If it wasn't for a good shepherd, the sheep wouldn't last very long. We have a good shepherd. We have a great shepherd. We have the shepherd that cares for us, and wherever it is we are, and he cares for us. Sometimes the struggles are difficult. Some things are tough, but he cares for us in the midst of whatever our situation is. And he loves you. The girl sang this morning, he loves you, he loves you. Amen, amen, amen. He loves you. And that is the basis. That's the basis of why we come together every week, is because God's tremendous love through His Son, through the Holy Spirit, to us. And we come so that we can be encouraged, and that we can then carry that light into the world. It's really a great challenge for us. And he said, verse 50, and I know that His commandment, God's commandment, is eternal life. Therefore, the things I speak just as the Father has told me. And here's the thing, that God told Jesus told the Spirit, and he tells us, that we need to be people that bring eternal life to a lost and hurting world. At some point in the world, when God decides, that'll be an availability. There will be judgment. But the judgment of the people that are being judged have been brought upon themselves because they rejected the opportunity to be part of the family of God. It's a choice. Our lives are made up of choices. And the choice is, do we choose to follow Christ? Do we choose to accept Him and believe in Him? Or do we choose to go our own way? This is the two choices we have. And so we have an opportunity as believers to bring that choice to the world. We have an opportunity to bring that light to a hurting world. I want to suggest to you, I know Derek said earlier about 2020 being a bad year. And, you know, we may not have seen anything yet. Did you ever think about that? I know you didn't, because you're all optimists. But we may not have seen anything yet. There's a guy who preached out of Isaiah this summer when the big empire that was there said that the people came and said, the watchman came and said, you're going to fall. And I guess Babylon, they did fall just a couple days. Think what happened if we fell. I don't care about that. But what if all of a sudden that in 2021, the US of A begins to fall? I mean, we got every reason that we could. I mean, outside of this, like I'm talking about, we could, because, you know, God may begin the judgment. And so I think that we have, as the church, maybe the greatest opportunity that we've ever had in our lifetimes to proclaim the gospel because of the apprehension of people in this world. There are people that have, I had a call the other day, because this person called and said, it's the worst day of my life, Tom. I said, geez, that's pretty bad. I thought it was when you got married, but it wasn't. No, I didn't say that. No, I've known these people a long time, and she said, because the election went the wrong way, and I'm saying, that makes it the worst day of your life. And she went on to tell me about she's had some issues, but it all culminated. And I said to her, you know, this is only just this, you just can't inhabit your own little space and never do anything. You gotta trust God. And I said, this has become my motto through this time, is that we're all gonna die, and she's worried about she's gonna die, which we're all gonna die. And I know that's really a hard thing in our country to believe, because we have every indication we're never gonna die, but that's not true. And the second thing is that we can either die while we're dying, or we can live while we're dying. And she's selected to die while she's dying. She doesn't go out, she stays right in her chair all the time. And she's made that choice. And so it's an opportunity for us to be able to use common sense and to use the things we have, but to have an election or to have some other thing control our lives is really something that we need to set aside and to live those, to live that life out. And we all have, we've all got issues. And if you don't have an issue, I don't believe it. But, I mean, I went to get my flu shot the other day. Did you get your flu shot yet?
Yeah.
Good job. I got that high-powered one. They said it gives you extra strength. That's what I needed, some extra strength. And she said, well, I'm going to get your pneumonia. I said, I don't know. I thought I had one, but she gave me a booster in pneumonia. So I had one in one arm and one in the other, and now I'm ready to go. I didn't get the shingles shot. I think they're expensive, and I had shingles once, so I figured, well, I'm going to be in. Maybe I will. Not planning on it. But anyway, we take precautions to do the things that keeps us safe. But at the same time, we have to take the Word of God, the light of the world, into the world. And that's such a challenge for us these days, such a challenge. But we need to do it. We need to be people that reach out and that we care for other people. Sometimes we have to care for people that we don't really want to do. I mean, I've been in hospitals. I've been in lots of places where if I wasn't a pastor, they probably wouldn't let me in. But I've been in and ministered to people in the midst of that. And sometimes we just have to go where God calls us. So I want to challenge you as we move into our new week And that we understand that God wants us to take this message to a lost and hurting world. And maybe there's somebody in your life that you can share with that would be spared eternity in hell. Let me just call this a true story, one of my few. When I was in the North last week, or 2 weeks ago now, one of my cousins died. She is 92 years old. She was a professed atheist. And she was in the old people's, it's Meadowbrook, called Meadowbrook's a senior place for, she died, and she died the day, of, I think the day of the funeral I was doing. And I went the next morning, that was a Saturday morning, I went out to see the daughter and her husband. They're cousins, we've known each other for a long time. And she said that her mother passed away, and she knew her mother was an atheist because she didn't hold any, she told people that. And she said for a week she fought dying. She said she was just in turmoil the whole time. And then she said, Sandy said, I brought some hymns in and I started playing that music. And finally she had like a peace. I don't know what kind of peace it was, but a peace came over. But she fought dying because of what probably she was experiencing. Pardon? Right, exactly. And so this battle that was going on, and I'm thinking to Sandy, who professes to be a believer, but she knew her mother wasn't, and her and her sister, and this whole dying process was very, very tumultuous and difficult. She is 92 or 3 years old. Before I went north, I was down in Dade City, and one of my friends was 107. She was dying. She did die, actually, too. When I went to see her, I always talk to people because they say the hearing is the last thing to go, but Daisy died with great calmness and a sense of peace. You could sense the peace. She didn't talk or anything, but you could just see her. She was relaxed. And her daughter was there, and a friend of her daughter's that we prayed, and she just passed into eternity peacefully. And when you see that played right before your eyes, you realize that it's a true story. It is a true story. Heaven and hell are true. Yes. Eternal glory and life with Christ and the Father, or eternal separation and damnation. It's a true story. And the choice is yours. And that's the issue. Nobody can force you to do it, but we have to choose. And Deuteronomy, God said, I give you life, I give you death. Choose life. Jesus says, choose life. The Holy Spirit says, choose life. Tom says, choose life, because it's not just here and now, but it's here and eternal. So I pray that if your heart has not moved from not accepting, maybe you're just doing like these guys here, you say, well, I'm sorry, but not really. I would pray that in your heart and your mind that you would begin to believe and that you would tell others. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your care for us. We just thank you so much for your concern that we come to you, not so we can be beat up, but so we can be loved and encouraged. So we just thank you for that. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you hold just a minute here? One of the things that has come up in the last week or two is the situation with the mask and no mask. And some of the people that have asked that maybe we divide it a bit, so that maybe the suggestion was the last three rows are for people that want to wear masks, and there'd be a little separation, and the people that don't want to wear masks would be up front. I think that the choice is yours. I don't really, I think that would be a fine way to solve that problem. So there's some apprehension about that, and that's fine. I don't have a problem with that, but just, is that all right with you all? Thank you. That's how I used to run the city when I was mayor. That's why I only lasted one term. So we'll kind of start doing that, if you don't mind. And that would be nice. I'll just kind of separate that, the third row, just bring these up a little bit further. So that'll make maybe all of us, all the people more comfortable. Okay? Okay. Say amen. Aaron, see that? They had an amen song. All right, now, here we go. So know that we are Christians.
We are one, the Spirit.
Next week?
Yeah.
That wasn't a very deep voice, Dan.
Yeah, I'm not super confident, but I'm hoping so.
Okay, well, we're going to have the streaming at, so right at the time of the service, you can watch it, and we could maybe even stream it downstairs if some of you want to go down there. That was always my dream, that we'd have so many people that. That's why Gary bought the big TV. Well, anyway, I hope you have a great week, and I just thank you for your prayers, and thank you for just your support over the years. And Lord, we thank you and praise you and honor you, and we just pray and put our trust in you, and we want to have every opportunity that we can to share the good news of your love and to let people know that we are Christians because of our love, not only for one another, but for those that we come in contact with. We pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a great week. God bless you.